This is Clinton, Tennessee. Christmas time, 1956. Population 4,000. That's the high school basketball team in action against Lake City. They lost 63-43. Last year they won. Had a good football season this year, in spite of all the recent trouble. Clinton Pep Band plays Rock Around the Clock. And to all outward appearances, it's just another night in just another Tennessee community. But Main Street has not always been quiet. There have been mobs in the square before the courthouse, and riots that had to be broken up by the National Guard. And a white Baptist minister was beaten up on Broad Street. The violence in Clinton was news all over America and much of the rest of the world. But this is not a report on the National Guard in Clinton, or the tanks in the street, or the tear gas, or the burning crosses, but rather an examination after the fact, filmed in Clinton between December 4, when the Reverend Turner was attacked, and now. It is an attempt by See It Now and the citizens of Clinton to explore the chain of events and emotions which brought violence and shame and hope to this town. All the persons to be heard during this 60-minute report will be citizens of Clinton, with the exception of Judge Robert L. Taylor of Knoxville and John Casper of Washington, both active participants in the conflict. Of the 4,000 people who live in Clinton, more than 3,700 are white, and by tradition and custom, most of them believe in separate schools.
any newspaper is inclined to follow the thinking of the majority of the people in the community, and this community and I myself have favored segregation all down through the years. Back when this lawsuit was filed in 1950, we did everything we could to maintain segregation by trying to provide the Negro students with good, equal, but separate facilities.
Thank you.
failure to date has been failing to attack. Failing to attack. Failing to attack at every level and continuously. But we in the White Citizens Council say now, yesterday, today, and forever, as long as there is one living white man in the United States, the Supreme Court is not the law of the land. That decision is not the law of the land now, or it never will be. Never.
John Casper first came to Clinton on August 25 and threatened to close up the school if desegregation continued. Casper had certain qualities of leadership, and there were those in Clinton willing to be led. 103 days later, his boast was fact. An organized campaign of picketing, threats, dynamiting, and rioting had brought Clinton to the brink of anarchy. Casper has been arrested twice, but continues to lead the battle against Judge Taylor's order. School attendance, shrunk by parents' fear of violence, was at times as low as 260. The pressure mounted on everyone, the faculty, the parents, the students.
Thank you. For about 5 days, these Negro students,
having, of course, the legal right to attend Clinton High School, had stayed home because of harassment and hindrance and heckling and threats upon their lives and incidents that actually would make anybody scared. I chose to take such a stand on this moral principle, that as long as the law is the law, as it is in our land, and as long as they did personally choose to come to Clinton High School, their legal right, that they had a moral right to attend unheckled and unhindered and unharassed. It was this that prompted me to accompany them. Though there were quite a few hecklers, we made our way to the high school building without any overt incident. When I emerged from the school building about 5 or 10 minutes later, the hecklers were still there and they heckled me personally. About 300 yards away from the high school, we were far away from where the policemen were doing their duty, of course, in front of the high school. One of the Citizens Council members had stationed himself with about 3 other men on a corner. As I made my way to that corner, they jumped me.
though there had been little interest in the formation of the Human Relations Council some weeks before, the Myers became the main topic of conversation for the people of Levittown within a few hours of their arrival.
The whole thing centers around the word integration. Well, as Mr. Myers said, because his home has been anything but peaceful since he moved in. He's got three children, and evidently he feels that they will be accepted socially, and I don't feel that they ever will be. But the whole trouble with this integration business is that in the end, it probably will end up with mixing socially. And you will have, well, I think their aim is mixed marriages and becoming equal with the whites.
Do you intend to move?
At the time, no. It's a pretty impossible situation. We have our home here, and if the colored move in and run real estate values down, there are a lot of us, the GIs particularly, who are going to be more or less stuck with their homes.
What has been the effect of the Myers coming here?
Well, it's created a great deal of tension, not among the neighbors, because we all feel the same. But it's naturally made everyone tense in their home. I mean, this is affecting our homes.
But there are others who are for the Myers?
Yes, I've heard about them.
For what reason, do you think, do they support the Myers?
Frankly, I don't know what reasons they can have for it. If there are homeowners in Levittown, I don't see what reasons they can have for it.
Do you think Myers will be able to live here comfortably?
Comfortably? No. I'll do what I can to help to get them out legally and peacefully. And as far as accepting them socially, if that's what you mean, I could never do that.